Good morning, One Church. My name is Carlos. I'm going to be your service host today. We are One Church. We are a church of many campuses. We have campuses all over the Central Valley. If you have friends or family members that you want to invite, I encourage you to invite them. We have a list up here. If they live in any of these areas because they don't want to come here, then invite them there. They're like, oh, but I don't live next to Salida. Oh, good thing we got Riverbank. Boom. Manteca. Boom. Ripping. Yeah, et cetera, et cetera. Anyways, I am glad you guys are here today. I just want to go over a couple of announcements. First off, we have groups this Wednesday night. We've been having them, but if you haven't been there, now's your time to come. Wednesday night, 6:30 p.m., men's groups. We also have women's groups. Same time, same place, same location. And then we also have youth at that same time, so your whole family can be here at the same time. You guys don't have to separate or worry about anything there. And we have a little slide up there. And then we have our women's conference coming up in March for the women. I encourage you guys to be there. If you guys want some more information on that, you can see us in the hub at the end of service, and we can give you some more information, signing up details, etc. It's going to be at a local church, but it's going to be really, really fun. So I encourage you guys to be there. And then this is the start of a new month already. We're into March. How exciting. So going into the first weeks, we always have our fasting week. So this week we're starting our fasting week. If you guys want any more information or help with that, you can see us in the hub as well, and we can guide you through that or walk you through that. And then following that, Friday night, we're going to have our worship night, which we all get together and just worship and bring in the new month and see what God has in store for all of us. And that is it. If I have any more announcements, I will let you guys know. Or if you guys have any questions, you can see us in the back at the end of service. And we will get started with worship. God, thank you so much for what you're going to be doing in our lives this morning. I pray that your presence fills us. Your presence is here with us, God. Thank you for everyone that showed up. I know this is their destined to be here this morning, to hear what you have in store for us. God, we give you all the praise and worship this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, One Church. If you would like to stand and join us in some worship this morning, get those hands going. Thank you.
of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. You are more, you are more than my words will ever say. You are Lord, all creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I may know. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing
worship you and to honor you, Lord. It was my cross you bore, so I could live in the
You're the name above all names. us to stay right here in this moment. I need some people in this place that came for change. I need some people in this place that are ready for God to move in their lives. I believe we're caught up in the moment right now, and I don't want to leave it because I know God is in this place. And I want you to just do this one thing. As we sing Exalt in the Heavens, as we lift up praises to God, I want you to do this. Besides just lifting up your hands, I want you today to lift up your hearts and say, God, today I posture my heart to you. God, whatever I have inside of it that's a mess, whatever I walked into this place with, God, I give my heart to you. God, we posture our hearts to you today, Jesus, knowing, God, that you could restore our hearts, that you could put broken pieces back together, that you could restore marriages, that you could help us lead our family. Come on. I need some people in this place today that is expecting God to do something in their lives and not just having another moment in his presence, but saying, God, I won't leave this place the same. God, I need you to do something new in my life. I need some people in this place that are expecting a move of God. Let's sing that song one more. Let's sing that part one more time. As we exalt heaven today, as we lift up Jesus, say, God, you can have my heart. You can have everything I have to give you. The good, the bad, and the ugly, I give it to you today, Jesus. Let's sing this song one more time. Give him some praise in this place. Come on, can we put our hands together for the King of the glory, the King God that reigns over our lives, the King that we know that could change our situations. Can we give it up in this place for the God that we know is alive and is not just alive on Easter Sunday, but he's alive on every Sunday and every day that we choose to press into him. Oh, it's a beautiful Sunday in this place. I don't know about you, but I'm excited. I'm excited for what God has in store for us. I'm going to ask that you just stay in this presence with me as we transition to our next part of the service. And I got a word on my heart that I want to share with you guys. And I'm going to ask that you guys start heading to your seats. You guys can take a seat. But trust me, I want this moment to come back. A lot, if you've been here on a Sunday morning, you know that a lot of times we do altar calls. And today, there's going to be one. And I say that because of this. I want you to prepare your hearts to be able to hear from God today. I want you to prepare your minds to be able to say, God, touch me, change my life, rearrange me. Is anybody with me today? Amen. This is such a good morning to be at Salida campus. Welcome to One Church, everyone. My name is Isaiah. I'm one of the pastors here on staff. I'm not the pastor. The pastor is probably watching online. Pastor Chris Swigel and Pastor Brianna, she's with the kids this morning. Can we give it up for our pastors here? I don't get to say this a lot, but Pastor Chris and Brianna, they've done so much for me in my life. Thank you for the impact. Thank you for leading us fearlessly, and thank you for everything that you guys do. And I just wanted to honor them in front of everyone this morning and just say that. We're going to dive into the Word today, but I see Coach Bryce is in the building today. And if you guys don't know who Coach Price is, he's the lead basketball coach for Modesto Christian, and they just won section champions last night, right? Come on. And the reason why he's probably going to be mad at me for pointing him out and unfollowing me on Instagram, but I'll take the risk. The reason why I'm pointing him out is because Coach Bryce is not just a basketball coach, but the influence that he has over these young men is beautiful. And if you guys don't remember, they dedicated their season right here at One Church Salida in front, and we prayed for them. So I just want to give you guys an update that we're section champion winners. Come on, we have a church that our prayers work, guys. Our prayers work. Amen. Home game wins tonight. Come on. Let's do it. I'm super excited for what God's doing in your life, Pastor Bryce. I mean, Coach Bryce, Pastor Bryce, really. As you're loving on these teenagers, it's so good to see. Listen, I'm excited, as you could tell, to get into the Word today. And I believe that God has something for each and every one of us. As this week began, God began to deal with me and just move in my heart. And so if you're taking notes today, because Jesus does check your notes when you get into heaven one day, so you might want to take notes. If you're taking notes today, I have a sermon entitled, There's Something in the Water. There's something in the water. Turn to your neighbor, say, there's something in the water. And I know you guys are probably thinking about different times where you guys probably went out to eat and there was something in your water and it grossed you out. And I don't want you to think about those moments, but I want you to think of this moment and this topic that I'm going to bring up today, that there's something in the water. See, if you learn nothing today, if you learn nothing good today, I hope that you learn this. I always try to give some nuggets in my sermon, so if I don't say anything good, at least you can walk away with something, right? In the Bible, the word water is mentioned 722 times, okay? It's mentioned way more than hope, joy, and peace in other words. And this is straight from Google, so don't quote me on it, all right? And so 722 times in the book of Genesis chapter 1, it says this, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. But the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. You see, that tells us that way before even human beings were formed, and even the moment where God was able to give us his Spirit to form and live amongst us, that God lived amongst the waters. Because God's Spirit is not just something to take lightly, but to understand that God's Spirit has to rest somewhere. And so before it was even rested upon us, each and every one of us, that rested on the waters. And today I want to give you that thought, is that there's something in the water. You get where we're going today? Can you do me a favor? Can we pray real quick as I catch my breath? Let's pray. And Jesus, we thank you, God, for what you're doing in this place. I pray, God, you would open up our hearts and our minds, God, to be able to receive what you have for us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I got a quick story that I want to start off with. So me and my wife, we've been married for 7 years. We don't have kids, but I have a bunch of nieces and nephews. And last week, and I'm going to continually put them in my sermons until God blesses with kids, but last week I was with my nieces, and we were in a public setting, and before I got to the place, I don't know if any guys in here are like this, but I like to go to the gas station sometimes and get one of those like big gulps, right? And just drink soda from, it just tastes different from the machine. Is anybody else weird like that for me? Like me? I'm the only one. Okay. So I got one of those big sodas, and I drove to meet my sister, and I get there, and the whole time,
my nieces were running around. We're outside, and they're playing around and stuff like that. And so my oldest niece comes to my sister and continues to ask her. She says, "Mom, I'm thirsty. I'm thirsty." Now, me knowing that the only thing in my car I had was this big soda, I wasn't going to offer her the soda, not only because I wanted it for myself, but because I knew the soda wasn't going to quench her thirst, right? Because there's something in the water that does something different for our bodies than what anything else can. And there's something in the water when it comes to God that does something different in our lives than anything else can. Are you following with me today? In John chapter 5, we're going to go into the story, but I believe I got a word on my heart today, and here's what you're going to experience today. Today, I pray that you experience not just a stirring in your hearts, not just another experience on a Sunday morning where you feel good about yourself. I pray that you don't just like the songs that we just worshiped together with, but I pray that today, whatever you walked into this place with, that you leave changed. That you leave challenged. I pray that today that you leave marked by God, because there's a difference between being stirred by God and marked by God, and we're going to learn that today. In John chapter 5, if you're there with me, verse 1 through 7, we're going to read this real quick. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem to one of the Jewish festivals. And now there in Jerusalem, near the Sheep Gate, was a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which surrounded by five covered colonnades. And some other preachers and scholars believe that it was almost like a place of worship. It was almost like a building where people would come and expect God to move. And we're going to get into this right now. It says, here a great number of people used to lie, disabled people, the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed. And one who had been there for 38 years, when Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for so long, he asked him, "Sir, do you want to get well?" And the man responded, "I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in there, someone else always goes in before me and beats me." And in this story, I want you to get the picture where they're in the middle of the city, and a building similar to this, and a place similar to this. And they would gather with other people that had conditions. They would gather with other people that had things that were wrong in their lives. And they would sit and they would wait for this angel. The people believed that this angel would come down to stir the waters. And if you got into the water in the right time, that you would receive your miracle. They believed that there was something in the water. You get where we're going today? And so they would sit there. And this man in particular sat there for 38 years. And my first point is this, is that sometimes that God will make us wait longer than what we want to wait. And that God will make us move faster than we think we're going to move. But here's the thing. Here's the key in it all. That to trust God and to not leave a certain place or a certain thing too early, to not leave your marriage too early, to not leave your family too early, but to wait on God to tell you when to move. This man waited for 38 years. And some could say that he waited too long. Some could say he waited too early. But I'm here to tell you today that he waited for just the right moment for Jesus to see him in this situation, in this position, to walk up to him and say, "I notice you. I see you. And I'm about to do something in your life that could forever be changed and rearranged. And it's not just by the stirring of the waters, but it's the power that lives inside of me." Because if you continue to read the story, you get this, that the man never even touched the water. Because sometimes we don't need water to make us feel good. Sometimes we don't need to come into this place and say, "Pastor or preacher, help me feel better about myself so I can just survive another week." But we are the living water, and the water that's inside of us is all we need. The water inside of us gives us an opportunity to stir the waters for other people. The water inside of us gives us an opportunity to serve and to tell people about the good news of Jesus. And that's that he stirred our waters, right? Over 2,000 years ago, he came, he died on the cross, and he stirred our lives forever. so that way we could go and tell other people about him and stir their lives and create miracles. And church, I want to urge you today that we are people that creates miracles and put miracles in motion. And that we're not just people that come to this place and wait for the waters to be stirred for us, but we are the people that come and stir waters for others around us and in the city. Is anybody getting what I'm saying today? I hope so, because you guys are quiet. There's something in the water. And to get this, we have to understand that we're a part of this miracle that should be set in motion. But this miracle, we can't just sit and wait for it to happen. And every Sunday, we can't just come and say, God, I expect you to move in my life again. Except saying, God, I'm not going to leave until you, I act different, until I talk different, until you give me a different boldness to lead my family, until you give me a different boldness to walk in the faith that you've given me, right? And on to my next point is, you have to posture your heart. Because God cannot move in people's lives, people's churches, and people's communities without your heart being postured. God only operates in hearts that are pure, that are open, that are willing, that are ready for the seeds to be planted, for the waters to be stirred, right? And so in John chapter 4, if you'd go with me there, there's this chapter before. I did this on purpose. I'm joking. It just kind of lined up perfectly. John chapter 4, verse 11. There's a story about this woman at the well. And this story, it's a long story, but we're only going to read a couple of chapters. But in the story, there's this woman at the well, and Jesus is traveling. And the Bible says that Jesus did not have to go this way, but he chose to go this way. You know why? Because sometimes we have to understand that God's love is so sufficient for us. That God's love will do anything to hunt us down, to interrupt our lives, to step into our lives and say, this is what you need. Is that this is a moment that could forever change your life, and that's what he did for the woman at the well. In this story, there's a woman that's sitting there at the well in the middle of the day, the hottest part of the day, because this woman was with tons of different men, and I say tons is like five or six. I'm exaggerating, right? She was with a lot of different men, and so she was outcasted. And the culture back then was the Jews and the Samaritans, they did not talk to each other. And Jesus was a Jew, and this lady was a Samaritan woman, and Jesus walks up to her and says, let me get a drink of your water. And this is where we pick up right here in verse 11. It reads like this. Sir, the woman said, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is so deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock? But Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up for eternal life. And the woman said to him, sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. And he told her, go call your husbands and come back. And she replied, I have no husbands. Awkward, right? And here's the situation. That Jesus would even ask her this question, knowing her situation. And I want to speak a little bit about offense, because obviously we could go straight to this point and say, man, this woman would have been, I would have been offended. If Jesus is going to put me on blast like that, like, I would be offended, right? And here's the reason why he asked that question. He asked her that question to kind of see where her heart was postured towards. That it didn't matter what her situation was. He just wanted someone to be willing to drink from his water. He understood that there was something in the water that could change her life forever. He understood that there was something in the water that she needed. And not only that she needed, but the city that she was going to go back to that needed that water. He understood that there was something different about the water that he could offer. And so as he asks her this question to think, to have her think a little bit and say, where's your heart really postured at? So often we could get offended by things that we get that go on in the world. So often we get offended about things that happen to us. So often we could get offended and ask God, how can you let this happen to me? God, why are they asking me to serve, right? Why are they asking me to be a part of groups? Well, here's why, because there's a community here for you. And you have to be closest to the water and to the well as you possibly can. And it's important for you to get plugged into these things. And it's okay if we're offended because we're asking of different things that's outside of an ordinary Sunday. Because God is stirring something up inside of the church. But it's going to take for us to continue to stir the things, continue to stir waters for opportunities for other people to come and drink the water that changed our life forever. Does that make sense today? And in this story, I want to point out that it was so weird and awkward and offensive. But God loves us enough to offend us. When we're wrong, he loves us enough to offend us, to make us think, to make us say, wow, maybe I didn't see that point of view. Wow, maybe I should be thinking like that. That God loves us enough not to leave us in the condition that we walked into this place, but to change us from glory to glory. Are you with me today? And so God asks her this. Jesus asks her this question to challenge her, because obviously the condition that she was in, she didn't want to be in. But her heart had to be postured. Her heart had to be ready for what he was about to do. And this next point is that we just have to get thirsty about the things of God. We just have to get hungry about what God is doing through us and in us, and not just around us. It's so cool to see miracles happen. I love seeing miracles happen. I love seeing God move in other people's lives. I love seeing God move in family members and different things. I love seeing a church like this full on a Sunday morning at 10:45 service. I love this stuff. But there's a difference between seeing the miracles and being a part of the miracle that's going to take place. There's a difference between just coming and waiting for God to stir the waters and saying, God, I want to be a part inside the water, stirring it up for other people. Because we know that there's something in the water that could change people's lives. That could transform their lives. And if we just get back to the simple basics of preaching the word of God, of preaching his gospel, of understanding that Jesus came, he died on the cross for us, and that the gospel is more alive now than just on Easter Sundays, right? But that Jesus could come, and he could come and transform other people's lives as well. And we could be a part of stirring those hearts. And I pray today that you guys will pray for boldness. That you guys will ask God to help you live on faith on another level. Because it's so cool, like I said, to see miracles. But the only way we're going to see God on heaven here on earth is if we stir the waters. The only way we're going to be able to see our family members and situations change and the things that we keep getting ourselves into. The only way, if you want to break curses and generational curses, if you want breakthrough in your life, the only way to do that is to stir the waters. And not just sit here and wait for God to do something. Not for you to sit here and cry or get goosebumps on your fingers or your arms, right? But for you to say, God, I'm not going to leave here until I feel something different. God, I'm not going to leave here just stirred. God, I want to leave here changed. I want to leave here marked. I want to leave here different. I want to leave here being somebody that you've called me to be. I want to do the things and the miracles and see things happen with you on my side, doing it along with me. Are you getting me today? I'm going to start to close up because, like I said, I want to give you guys an opportunity to respond. And this last thing is, like I said, is just get thirsty about the things of God. There's no more time for us to waste, to just sit back and sit there for 38 years even sometimes and just wait for God to move. The same spirit that God is talking to this woman about is the same spirit that's inside of us. The same living water that he offers this woman, this is the same living water that he could offer you today. The same living water that this woman chose to drink from is the same living water that maybe you've already chose to drink from. And all it's going to take today is just to stir up the waters just a little bit more and saying, God, I know that this is what you're doing. I know what I see around me, but God, I want to be a part of the stirring process. God, I want to be a part of moving miracles in motion. God, I want to see people's lives change, people's lives transform. God, I'm not satisfied with just waiting and hoping that you move. But God, I'm expecting for something to happen. And God, I'm going to posture my heart to you and expecting that you're going to do something. God, I'm not going to just hope that you save my marriage. I'm not just going to hope that you save my kids, but I'm going to expect that you're going to do that. This last thing is that you had to get thirsty. I have a story I want to share with you as I start to wind down here. When I was a kid, I went grocery shopping with my mom. And if parents, you guys probably know this, that kids ask for things when you're grocery shopping and make you spend more than what you want to spend. And I remember as a kid, I went grocery shopping with my mom, and I must have been one of those kids, because it was one of those times where I really needed something, and she kept saying no. I told my mom, Mom, I'm thirsty. And she was like, you can wait until we get home. The whole grocery shopping time, I was thirsty. I remember I was so thirsty. We finally get our groceries, we pack them in the car, we drive home. And as soon as we hit the driveway, I ran out of the car and straight to the front of the house where the hose was. Because back in my day, we rode our bikes and we drank from the water hose and all that stuff. And I remember taking the water hose and putting my lips around the thing, about to turn on the water, and I felt something latch onto my lip. And it wasn't a kiss. I wish it was. It was a spider. And I slapped the spider off my mouth. I ran straight inside the bathroom. I didn't cry at this point, okay? I ran straight inside the bathroom, and I did what anybody else would do. I looked in the mirror. I seen my lip swelling up, and I checked if I was Spider-Man. I started slinging. And I was, at that point, I was like, shoot, like a spider got me. I was nervous to tell my mom, and finally I come out and tell my mom. We started icing my lip. And if you don't believe me, I still have a mark, a black dot on my lip. You can see it after service, and I'll sign. No, I'm joking. But I still have the black dot on my lip. Because people, there's a difference between being stirred by God and being marked by God. And this moment where this lady at the well had this moment and encounter with Jesus, she was marked by God. The moment that Jesus decided to take a different route to get to her, she was marked by God. The moment that Jesus decided to take a different route to get to you, you are marked by God. And I pray that today in this place, that you're not just stirred by God, but you're marked by God. And maybe you forgot about that. Maybe it's been a while that you thought about being marked by God. Today, I pray that you remember that you're marked, that you're called, that you're chosen. And it means more for us than just to see this building filled, but it means even more for us to see people that are willing to stir the waters, to place miracles in motion, and to understand, I've been marked by God. God changed my life, and he could do it for other people. I'm going to give you guys a moment to respond to this word, and we're going to open up the altar. If you feel safe and you feel like you want some prayer, we're going to do that. And I'm going to ask if you just stand in this place today. And I'm going to challenge you with this last question. This last thought is today, will you be the person in the middle of the city waiting for waters to be stirred? Or will you be the woman at the well, okay with being offended a little bit, to allow God not to just move in your heart and life, but in others? Are you okay with saying, God, you could have my life, you could have my heart that's postured to you, and I want to just see you move? Are you okay with doing those things so you could see the heaven touch earth? How many people want to see other people saved? How many people want to see the city touched? How many other people want their lives to be different, right? And here's the key of it. Is we can't just be satisfied with being stirred. We have to tell God, God, I need an encounter like you, like the woman at the well. I want to be marked forever. I want to be so marked that I'm a part of things. I want to be so marked where I'm excited to show up early to church. I want to be so marked where I start to lead small groups. I start to talk to people randomly at the gas station about what you've done in my life. Are you getting me today? God, I don't want to be stirred any longer. I want to be marked. I want to be different. I want people to know and understand when I'm walking that it's you inside of me. And there's nothing else that could separate that. And I want to give you an opportunity today to respond. We're going to go into the song, and I'm just going to open up the altars, and we're going to be able to work and pray and come around and pray with you. But I just want to give you an opportunity to say, God, I posture my heart. God, no longer am I going to be satisfied with just a moment in your presence. God, I want to be a person that works Sunday through Sunday, cultivating and stirring waters in other people's lives, so that way you can get the glory, that way you could get the honor, and that way you could transform their lives. God, I pray in this place, if you just bow your heads as we pray. Maybe you're in this place today and you've never experienced this living water that I've talked about. Or maybe you're in this place today and you haven't experienced this living water in a while. And you want to ask Jesus to come to your life. You want to ask Jesus to be the living water in your life. If you just raise your hand, lift up your hand on the count of three, I want to give you that opportunity to invite Jesus into your life today. One, two, three. Amen. I see those hands. Amen. We're going to pray for these people that lifted their hands this morning, and then we're going to open up these altars. And God, I pray, God, for everyone's hearts, God, just to be open right now. And if you guys will just pray this prayer with me, God, I know that I'm a sinner, and I need you in my life. And I pray that you would come into my life, that you would be the Lord and Savior of my heart and my life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to open up these altars. The worship's going to worship, and I want to encourage you. I want to urge you to be a part of the water, to get inside, because there's something in the water that's different. There's something when I get a drink of water from Jesus that does my life different. That I could turn around and say, if Jesus did it for me, he could do it for you as well. I'm going to open up these altars.
Your good.
I want to stay in this moment real quick. I want to stay in this moment because God has something for you. God, I want you guys to close your eyes right now in this time, and I want you to think of your lowest point. Think of the time that hits you the hardest. Even if it's right now, just close your eyes and remember that. Remember that, and remember that you weren't alone in that time, because Jesus was right there. And Jesus is right there. And that's why he is worthy. And that's why he is there for you. And that's why we sing this song. And I just want to sing it again. I want to sing it one more time. And just remember that. When you sing it, remember that Jesus was there right next to you in your time of need, in your time of desperateness. Jesus is there for you if you are in your time of need. I just want to sing that again with that in your mind, because he is worthy of it, and we want to say thanks to him because he has been there.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Worthy, Lord. Worthy is the Lamb, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, for the work that you're doing here, Lord. If you could quickly just have a seat real quick. I want to enter into a time of worship through giving of tithes and offering. And here's the thing, is that one thing I love about this church is we're going to take a minute to celebrate the Lord in this way. And I know a lot of, if you've been to other churches, you might have, you know, seen that they just take a second, right? They might quote a scripture, they might say a quick prayer. But we like to actually take a little time and spend time in worshiping the Lord in this incredible and powerful way. And as I was just reflecting on the song and the words of the song, I was thinking about the book of Revelations and the end times. And the four creatures and the 24 elders are gathered around the throne of God, and they're asking him, who is worthy? Who is worthy to take the scroll and open its seals? And then the angels and the 24 elders and the creatures that were around the throne, they said, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. The Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. He alone is worthy. He alone is worthy. Thank you so much, worship team. And thank you, Pastor Isaiah. What an incredible word that we received this morning about the stirring of the waters in our hearts. And this is what giving's about also. It's about stirring the waters in your heart of what God wants to do in you and through you to reach the community around us and this world around us in the city of Salida, the place that we have been called to this morning. And I want to talk to you this morning about one aspect of where, when you give to this local body, when you give to this church, you know, sometimes I think for those who are giving, who are already invested in that, who are already doing that, you already get it, you understand it. But for maybe those who are new to this idea about the generosity God is calling us into and the stewardship he's calling us into, you know, I think I get it. Some people are like, practically like, where's the money going? What are you doing with the money? You know, I get all of that. I get all that. And I wanted to share with you one aspect of that. And the thing that God put in, like, placed on my heart this morning was talking to you about the generations. And so we're a church about the generations, not about just the older generation or the, you know, middle-aged generation, but we're also a church that's about the next generation that's coming up. And don't you know that the world we live in is super challenging for our young people? It's a crazy world we're living in, and they need Jesus to come into their hearts and their lives in a new and a powerful way. And I'm so thankful for the workers that have been placed and have been called into this church, who are feeding into the lives of our young people. On Sunday mornings and on Wednesday nights, we have over 45 kids right now that are joining in, learning about Jesus and about the gospel message. And the scriptures tell us that if we raise up a child in the way they should go in their old age, they won't depart from it. So it's so powerful. And Jesus also tells the disciples when the kids are trying to come to him and they're like, you know, get away from Jesus. He's too busy. He don't have time for you. He says, hey, don't prevent them from coming to me. Such are these that are going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. We have to become like little children. It's such a powerful time for us to reach the children and this next generation, because this next generation is going to be the generation of leaders. They're going to be the generation of missionaries. They're going to be the generation of pastors. They're going to be the generation of teachers that's going to come up after us. And we have to invest in that. So when you give to this local body, you're not only giving for all the ministries that are happening across this church, I want you guys to catch the vision of what God wants to do. It's beautiful to see all of your faces here today. And when we partner together, when we can partner together, we can give God our heart. We say, we submit ourselves to you in this way, Lord. The powerful thing that he's going to do in your life and through your life to reach the city of Salida and beyond to the whole world. So let me pray this morning as we get prepared to give. And you can see the slide and the ways to give. We have the baskets down here where you can take those envelopes from the back, seat back pockets in front of you and place them in the buckets. And we have baskets at the rear of the church also. So we got you covered in all the ways to give. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord God, so much for the work that you are doing here, Lord. I pray that you would help us, Lord God, to posture our hearts, Lord. Just as Pastor Isaiah was talking about, posturing our hearts to receive, Lord, this living water that you are stirring up, Lord God, that flows from your throne, Lord, that flows to us, Lord God. But it's not just designed to flow to us, it's designed to flow through us, Lord, to the world around us, Lord God. And we have this opportunity to partner with you, Lord, in this area of giving, to submit ourselves to you, Lord God, and say, Lord, we are going to give back that first 10% as a tithe to you, Lord. We're going to bring it into your storehouse, Lord God, and we are going to do above and beyond by investing in missions and in kingdom builders from the local churches and beyond us, Lord God. We thank you so much, Lord God, for allowing us this opportunity, and we pray in Jesus' name that you would just bless us, Lord God, and help us, Lord God, to be used for your glory and for your honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, 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 amen. What a great service. You guys enjoy that service? Amen. Amen. I just wanted to finish it off with a couple things. We have our bulletin. If you didn't get one on your way in, grab one on your way out. And then we also have this cool Connect card if you guys is first, second time here, or you haven't been here in a while, or you just need some information, feel free to fill this out and bring it to us. We'll be back in the hub back there. And if you guys need any prayer at all for any reason, little or small, feel free to join us back there, and we'll have a prayer partner connected with you. If you guys have any questions, information, you guys can see me or anybody with a little badge, or you can see us in the hub. Thank you guys. Have a great weekend. You're never